program, online training program for doctors on management of chronic morbidities. As all are aware that COVID pandemic has already stepped into the lockdown period, has stepped into the 46th day. And today is the 46th training program that we are hosting from Rajiv Gandhi Institute of Health Sciences. So there are two coincidences here. And we have been conducting training programs for doctors, for nurses, for allied health sciences, and for all segments of healthcare workers on behalf of Government of Karnataka. And we are almost touching around 1 lakh people who have been benefited out of it. And that's a great achievement as far as training is concerned. This capacity building has been going on right from the day the lockdown was announced. And today's program is specifically dealing with the management of chronic morbidities. So all of you are aware that any morbidity, comorbidity that is with COVID is a deadly combination. Almost patients, it leads to more mortality. And today's program is being organized by Rajiv Gandhi Institute of Health Sciences with the following faculty members: Dr. Nagaraj B.S., Professor of Medicine from BMCRI. Sorry, he will be giving an introduction to the session, followed by Dr. Ramesh D., former professor of cardiology at Jadhav Institute of Cardiological Sciences. And he'll be talking on management of chronic cardiovascular disease. Dr. Satish Babu, consultant endocrinologist from Sparsh Hospital, he'll be talking on management of diabetes mellitus and other endocrinological diseases. And Dr. Shashi Bhushan, professor of pulmonology from BMCRI, will talk on management of chronic respiratory disease. So we have each specialist talking to us on cardiovascular, endocrinal, and also respiratory diseases. How these diseases play a role in COVID-19 situation, pandemic, and how we can recognize and also manage these cases is what is the focus of today's discussion. Without much ado, I would like to first of all thank all the faculty members for accepting this invitation from Rajiv Gandhi Institute of Health Sciences and coming over and helping us out in organizing this online training program. I would invite Dr. Nagaraj B.S., Professor of Medicine, BMCRI, to take over from here and kindly conduct the session.
Thank you, sir. Good afternoon, everybody. Mm-hmm. Management of chronic comorbidities during COVID-19 pandemic. This is a very, very important topic which we want to discuss during this pandemic. Next slide. This SARS-CoV-2 virus looks a very tiny virus, but it has brought our civilizations to a standstill. And all big brothers of this world are on their knees because of this virus. Next. So as of today morning, 9:30, this is the number of cases what you have got, around 36,72,238 cases. And last 24 hours, you have got around 83,465 cases in the world reported. And India is also similarly affected. We have got around 37,916 as of today's morning active cases, out of which around 16,539 have been discharged or they are cured. And Karnataka, we have got around 693 cases. This is a quite huge number throughout the world and Karnataka. And some things we know about this virus, many things we don't know about this virus. Among something what we know about this virus is comorbidities. Comorbidities play a very, very important role, and this is a figures from around 2,469 patients early what they saw in New York. One of the common factors they can see is around 50% of them had hypertension and comorbidities. You can see they got other comorbidities like diabetes, and this is the commonest. More than 50% of the patients, some people have got more than one comorbidities. This is very common. So the occurrence of this SARS-CoV-2 is more common in people who have got comorbidities. Well, okay, then coming to the how they fare once they got infection. This is a data recently published, last week it is published. It is a database from 169 hospitals across Asia, Europe, North America, and admitted between December 20th to March 15th, 2020. around 8,910 patients with COVID-2 are admitted. Out of that, total 515 have died. That is a mortality of around 5.8. So what is common in these patients is next. Okay. We can see here independent predictors of in-hospital mortality. These are the things which they have looked. Most of the patients who have died, risk factors present. These are the risk factors: cardiovascular, COPD, diabetes. Okay, these are the common risk factors which are present in people who have died. Next. And among the survivors and non-survivors, most of the people who have not survived, they have had these comorbidities like coronary artery disease. You can see around 20%, congestive heart failure, arrhythmias, diabetes, hypertension, COPD. So these comorbidities are present in most of the patients who have died. And this is again from China, a retrospective study. Here also you can see chronic comorbidities which are present are hypertension, diabetes. So all of these studies, in conclusion, what they, in summary, next slide. In summary, what they show is, in all laboratory confirmed patients, comorbidities show poor clinical outcomes. Many people have fared very badly once if they have got comorbidities. And greater the number of comorbidities, they are also correlated with poorer clinical outcomes. So with this background, comorbidities are one of the important things which already we know that it will has got a lot of impact in the outcomes of these patients. To discuss these comorbidities, how to manage them, we have got a distinguished panel already been introduced. First beginning, we'll start with Dr. Ramesh, former professor of cardiology, General Institute of Cardiology. He'll be talking on management of chronic cardiovascular disease, how to manage these patients. Dr. Ramesh.
Good afternoon, everybody. At the outset, I must thank Mr. Sachidananda, Honorable Vice Chancellor of Rajiv Gandhi Health University, and my dear friend Dr. Nagaraj, Professor of Medicine, for having given me an opportunity to come over here and discuss about the management of heart disease in the COVID-19 pandemic. People are talking, much water has thrown down the river Kaveri, and people are talking about COVID-19 left, right and center. But what they don't realize is, it's still a baffling and bewildering virus despite having a plethora of information and documents and data. Why? It has affected more people than expected and has closed national borders and has brought this world to standstill and turning the economy into topsy-turvy. More than anything else, it still defies rational thinking and logical understanding despite having a robust data and epidemiological studies. Unlike other pandemics which have been witnessed in the past, this is a mother of all pandemics. Why? It is so unique and it differs from other pandemics so far that has been explained. One, very initial stages of this outbreak, said just 2 months old, when the coronavirus was 2 months old, the WHO brought up and said that it is of international concern, which was not defined or declared in the previous pandemic. And the second important thing is, there is no specific treatment, and no, you cannot prevent corona because vaccine is not available. So what is that more important is idiosyncratic. That means some simple measures, simple personal hygiene and maintaining social distancing does not prevent the disease, but it controls the spread of pandemic. And ultimately, it is ridiculous to tell that you save other people's life by staying inside in your house or quarantining yourself and washing your hands. So this is the unique characteristics of this pandemic. So now the pandemic is in the world is in the grip of COVID pandemic. So the main chief organ, vital organ that is affected in this pandemic is lungs, as you all know, and more descriptions and the disease process has been explained in detail in the lungs by the physicians. But the next one that is affected is a vital organ is heart. Why is that the heart has gained importance now? Way back in the early stages of the pandemic, from Chinese study, we came to know that the coronavirus not only affects the lungs, but also affects the heart. That is known as acute cardiac injury. It is in the tune of 20 to 25%, and this was well described first time in that. And why is that this heart gets affected in coronavirus? It is because it has the mechanism explained is that since the coronavirus enters the cells which have got AC2 receptors, they are predominantly present in the alveoli of the lungs, but also in the cardiovascular system. Hence, by attacking the AC2 receptors, not only in the lungs, but also in the heart, they directly cause the damage of the cardia. And there is what is known as cytokine storm, which can cause the immune response, which can cause the cardiac damage. And apart from that, the severe hypoxemia induced in lungs can affect the oxygen demand of myocardium and thereby reducing the efficiency of the heart. More than anything else, the cells like lymphopenia, the first line of defense, has also disorganized and inhibited, so that the cardia also becomes a target of damage. And there are so many studies which prove that the involvement of cardia in coronavirus varies from 10 to 25%. All the studies are from the China and the South Korea, because they are the ones which had the maximum number of infections, coronary infections. And the mechanism of the coronary sinus has been described ad nauseum. I will not go into details, but only thing I tell, as soon as it gains its entry into the cells through AC2 receptors, it manipulates the manifold so much it causes viremia, which in turn causes what is known as cytokine storm. And this is the one which causes the myocarditis. So what is the end result of the myocarditis? Either you can have a decompensated heart failure, or that is reduced LV function, or arrhythmias. So these are the two important things that are the sequelae of coronary infection. So either you have impaired cardiac function or arrhythmias in the form of tachyarrhythmia, bradyarrhythmia. So far, they have never known that they thought that cardia can be involved only in the later stages. But however, there is one study which showed that coronavirus can also cause fulminant myocarditis. Fulminant myocarditis is nothing but the infection of the heart to such an extent the patient goes into a cardiogenic shock with a severe reduced LV function. So here you had a 63-year-old male patient who had pneumonia and a cardiac patient, and they diagnosed that the involvement of the cardia by increased levels of interleukin and troponin. And by treating this patient viremia with antivirals, they were able to reduce the levels of they treat the underlying cardiac disease, as a result which was reflected in the reduction of the inflammatory markers. And so patient recovered with ejection fraction which was very about 20 to 30%, improved to normal. Subsequently, patient died because of second bacterial infection. So fulminant carditis can still occur in a patient with coronary heart in the coronavirus infection. So the inflammation of the heart is primarily, it can affect in a patient with comorbid conditions of cardia like hypertension or diabetes or ischemic heart disease gets affected with coronavirus infection, or coronavirus infection can produce cardiovascular morbidity mortality by direct inflammation. So when such is the case, when a patient with coronavirus infection presents with breathlessness and chest pain, to the treating physician or a cardiologist or a healthcare professional is confused, because both the cardia and the lung pathology have similar symptoms, breathlessness and chest pain. So they are totally disoriented, they do not know what to treat, and they are confused, and they probably may miss the cardiac treatment and causing a cardiovascular morbidity and mortality if they ignore that. So, but if they treat the cardia when there is no symptoms of signs of cardiac inflammation, then they are probably over-treating and still causing death. So one should be very specific to know which organ is involved when you treat the coronary virus infection. How do we diagnose whether this particular patient, a coronavirus patient, has got a underlying cardiac involvement? So these are the cardiac biochemical markers. So pro-BNP, troponin, D-dimer, pro-calcitonin, which you all of you know, which has been widely extensively used, and it's a best-side investigation. But in cardia, people, the treating physicians and cardiologists are using pro-BNP and troponin as a cardiac surrogate marker and as also as a prognostic indicator. So higher the levels of these two levels, they have got the tendency to treat the underlying cardiac disease, which should not be done. Therefore, now the EHC guidelines, European Society of Cardiology, as well as American Heart Society of Cardiology says that routine measurements of cardiac troponin, T and BNP should be discouraged. Because why? Because looking at the high levels of troponin, T and BNP in the absence of cardiac involvement, they're likely to treat the cardia and cause more deaths and than the disease itself. So the treatment will be worse than the disease itself. And secondly, you have got drugs which are quite extensively used. So this is the drug approved by WHO, used for the management of coronavirus infection. Here I would like to mention specifically ivermectin. This ivermectin is an antiparasite drug which is extensively used in South America for the treatment of antiparasite, onchocerciasis, and Dr. Fusozin of Peru has tried this ivermectin in about 100 patients, and he reports that and claims that 96% of the patients have recovered when they were almost on the cardiorespiratory disorder. But the FDA has not approved for the management of ivermectin, so that we have to wait for the further data before it could become a routine line of treatment. Then convalescent plasma, everybody is aware. The other like lopinavir and ritonavir studies, virus antiviral studies have also come, and they have got said to have a significant role in the management of virus. More than anything else, that is tocilizumab and cilsilumab, an anti-interleukin receptor antibodies has a promising in the management of promising role in the treatment of coronavirus. Hydroxychloroquine and chloroquine has been a subject of debate, and because of this extensive use, I think it is also out of the reach of many of the patients and many of the treating doctors. But one should remember that there are the drug is yet to produce a significant amount of the management, and because of its cardiotoxicity, one should be extremely careful when you use hydroxychloroquine and chloroquine, especially when you use with azithromycin, which is an antibiotic use, which can cause a conduction disturbance, especially prolonged QT causing torsade dyspointis. So whenever you use hydroxychloroquine, see that you measure the QT interval on a regular basis to prevent the torsade dyspointis. Yeah, at this juncture, I would like to point out two of the cardiologists in the North media, they used hydroxychloroquine as a prophylactic to prevent coronavirus infection. Unfortunately, they lost their life because they couldn't measure their QT interval. So measurement of QT interval is the most important thing one should always do when you are using hydroxychloroquine. ACE inhibitors have been tried in some of the studies because ACE is a receptor which allows the virus inside the cell. Therefore, by inhibiting the entry of the virus into the cell, they thought they could prevent virus infection. And however, there is no evidence to say that this drug should be used in a routinely because the robust data is lacking. Corticosteroid should never be used. It should not be used because there's no data to support that use of corticosteroids improves the outcome in patients with coronavirus. However, whenever a patient has got ARDS, we can use low dose of dexamethasone to prevent the patient from progressing into deteriorating and also to reduce the mechanical ventilation time. And in Indian scene, these are the following antiviral drugs that are commonly used. All of them have a cardiotoxicity underlying that. And let us look at what are the cardiac toxicity drugs when you use all this. Antimalarials, as I pointed out, they can have conduction disorders or they can produce cardiomyopathy. Antivirals can cause anemia, hepatotoxic, and torsade dyspointis. Remdesivir, which is now the drug of contention between and a drug that is being fought over both by Russians and Americans. Now, both the cardiovascular side effects and its organs are unknown. trastuzumab, hepatotoxicity. So one should be careful and know the side effects of the drugs when you are commonly used. Now, why is that we need to have this webinar in the management corner of management of cardiovascular disease in the pandemic? It is because of the lack of the healthcare resources. We have a compromised healthcare resources, which we cannot cannot cater to both the COVID patients as well as to the non-COVID patients. So since we have to prioritize the health infrastructure for the management of COVID patients, which is causing mortality and morbidity, the non-COVID patients will have to take a back seat. So in order to provide a guidance where both COVID and non-COVID patients can have access to cardiac management, I think this is the seminar where we have got it. So we have got what is known as not a guideline, it's a guidance document. So this guidance document is provided here and shown here to show that this can help you to treat both COVID and non-COVID patients equally. And these recommendations will never override the recommendations already stated by the national guidelines regulatory bodies. So this guidelines help you to prevent, to see whether to make a differential diagnosis and treat the particular organ that is involved. Now, the question after having a lab investigation, the question that commonly asked in a cardiology department, we have what is non-invasive imaging. Do we need to do it regularly or regular basis? Yes, you should never perform routine cardiac imaging in a patient with suspected confirmed COVID as per COVID-19, as per the European Society of Cardiology and European Society of Hypertension Society. They say that you should never perform a cardiac imaging on routine patients. So why? It is because the doing so, it helps in the spreading of the disease and also in spreading the disease not only to the patient, also to the treating physicians and to the medical personnel. So what are the investigations one should not stress test? Cardiopulmonary, transesophageal echocardiography and CT should not be done. How about echocardiogram? Whenever a patient comes with chest pain and breathlessness to a casualty, it is a common tendency to ask for echo to rule out whether the patient has got underlying LV dysfunction or not, though the patient has got a lung pathology. But subjecting all the suspected patients of COVID to an echocardiography has a nidus for the virus to spread further, infecting not only the other patient but also the treating physicians. Therefore, we have got a protocol which has come from American Society of Echocardiography. Whenever a patient comes to emergency ward with dyspnea of the grade 3 and 4, first do an ECG X-ray. If you find that he has got a lung pathology, then don't do echocardiogram. But if you don't find anything, then you send for a COVID testing and wait till the COVID report comes. If the COVID report comes negative, you do it. But you cannot wait for the COVID report to come. It can take hours or days. So in such a case, and if you find that this doing echocardiography is going to influence your treatment, saving patient life, then you should use and treat that particular patient as COVID positive and use PPE and do the echocardiogram. So echo should be done not routinely, only in selected patients, only when it impacts your line of management. How about doing CT scan? CT scan is done regularly by the pulmonologist, physicians, and emergency physicians to document or to confirm the diagnosis of coronary virus infection. However, if you find an obstructive coronary artery disease, if you suspect a patient has got obstructive coronary artery disease and you may require an intervention or further management, you can get a CT coronary angiogram, which is a bit safer, which does not infect the other disease personnel. So now coming to the medical management, there was a controversy that one should not use aspirin because it has got the potential to increase the coronary virus infection. But however, it is the non-steroidal inflammatory drugs which can increase. So if at all you want to use a anti-inflammatory drug, aspirin paracetamol is much safer than the non-steroidal, and aspirin can be used because low dose of aspirin has got a low anti-inflammatory effect, so it can be safely used and should never be withheld as an antiplatelet agent in a patient with COVID or a non-COVID patient. Statin therapy, in fact, has a favorable outcome in patients with influenza and pneumonia. However, some patients who are known to exhibit rhabdomyolysis and increased liver enzymes, in such situation, we can withhold it. Now, coming to the most important aspect, hypertension. The concerns regarding the use of antihypertensive drug in the management of hypertension is that ACE and ARBs are known to reduce blood pressure through ACE and ACE receptors. So there was a report saying that the coronavirus infection uses ACE and ARB, ACE receptor to get into viremia. But simultaneously, the ARBs and ACE are known to upgrade the ACE receptors and therefore increase the risk of infection. However, this is only a hypothesis and we do not have any sufficient data to say that this is a phenomenon. So you can safely use ACE and ARBs as an antihypertensive patient in a patient with coronavirus infection, and we should not withhold ACE and ARBs just because the patient has got COVID-19. So there's no need for the patient to come and physically to come here to you and have a hypertension for a cardiac for the control of high blood pressure. You can do what is known as a remote control. Remotely you can monitor the blood pressure, and such patients should continue the treatment. So all antihypertensive treatment should be continued as per the guidelines without stopping ACE or ARBs. Over the management of acute coronary syndrome, in the era of COVID-19, doing an invasive procedure is known to have its own personal, have a risk not only of spreading the disease and also causing the risk to the operating physician. So therefore, it is now suggested that fibrinolysis should be done instead of doing primary angioplasty. So wherever you feel that a particular person requires primary angioplasty, fibrinolysis is the drug of choice, as it is known to reduce the spread of infection. All elective surgeries, non-essential medical and dental procedures to be delayed. So when do you do coronary interventions? Sorry. So when do you do the coronary invasive procedure? Whenever you have had a failed thrombolysis or a patient with a compromised hemodynamics with acute myocardial infarction, and patients who are not responding to the optimal medical management, such patients deserve and needs coronary interventions or an invasive procedure. So how do you do that in a coronary pandemic? So if at all you are doing a PCA, kindly do the PCA only in the culprit vessel. Though you have got a multivessel disease, culprit vessel should be attempted. So the lesser the time spent, lesser is the chances of spreading the infection. And single room procedure should be designated for the care with almost a negative pressure if possible. So in acute myocardial infarction, multidisciplinary team, that is heart care team should be done, and it should be discussed. And emergency interventional thrombolysis is the first choice in STEMI. And if at all you require, then we need to have a contained hospital equipped with a cath lab, which is caters exclusively for COVID-19 patients. So this can be set up in a hub. What is this? We call it as a COVID hospital hub. So where the cardiologist and the cardiac personnel are stationed here, and they do not operate the non-COVID patients. How about the patients with valvular disease? All valvular procedures should be postponed, protein procedures. However, patients who have got a left and right lung impairment and who have got hemodynamic instability need to be operated. So here the choice of intervention should be guided by the heart team. Pulmonary embolism, acute pulmonary embolism should be treated, and usually we need to do a thrombolysis. So a NOAC should be avoided, and heparin can be used safely in this particular patient. How about in a patient with heart failure? We have got two types of heart failure, acute heart failure. So acute myocardial injury can reduce into heart failure. So this is primarily due to, because of stress-induced cardiomyopathy, due to the cytokine cytokine storm, and secondly, it can also be as a sequelae of the coronavirus infection, and thirdly, due to the presence of coexisting heart disease, which gets aggravated because of the infection. So the data of heart failure in COVID-19 is still lagging. So however, all anti-failure drugs which are used routinely in acute heart failure should be used here without any problem. And in chronic heart failure, one should use ACE and ARBs routinely. So one should not withhold ACE and ARBs or a beta blocker, thinking that this could affect the course of the coronavirus infection. So as per the data, as per the guidelines, one should continue the management of chronic heart failure. How about arrhythmias? Elective ablations and cardiac device implantation should be postponed. Critical ill patients with VT, VF require treatment can be managed medically with where IV imidazoline should be the choice of treatment. However, if the patient has got tonsillitis pointis, IV magnesium, IV isoproterenol can be used safely. Now, this is the table which summarizes what should be done in emergency and what should not be done in a COVID pandemic. So all emergencies, like a patient who has got acute STEMI, who was not responding to failed STEMI, and a patient who has got STEMI with compromised hemodynamics, should be undergo procedure immediately. One should not wait for that. Patients with valve heart disease, aortic stenosis, dissection of aorta, and as well as the severe valvular regurgitation should undergo the procedure without waiting for the COVID pandemic to be over. Chronic heart failure, which has got a compromised LV dysfunction, who has got a poor outcome, need to be surgically operated. And pacemaker implantation, especially a temporary pacemaker implantation, when the patient has got a severe bradycardia, who has got a conduction disturbance, should not be denied of a pacemaker. Ultimately, pericardiocentesis should be done in cardiac tamponade. Many of them feel that cardiac pericardial effusion or a cardiac tamponade is a sequel of coronary virus infection. So treating that reduces the pericardial effusion. No, it should be treated because they are likely to go into cardiac tamponade and cause morbidity and mortality. So in the era of COVID pandemic, you can follow up a cardiac patient either by a video follow-up or by a teleconsultation. And during this 1.5 months or 2 months of lockdown, we have found that the coronary interventions in non-COVID patients have drastically come down. So this is known as mystery of missing STEMIs, which has been documented in our world across. And the intervention procedures have come down drastically from 57% to 81%, so which was unknown. So what was the reason for all this? It is all because of two factors. One is the patient factor. Because of lack of transplantation, they do not have access to the medical management, and also because of the fear of infection, staff and triage and prioritization. So the incidence of the coronary interventions have come down. So the most gratifying outcome of a dreaded infection is a simple thank you when the patient was almost on the ventilator. So even in the COVID-19 pandemic, you can treat a diseased heart and make a healthy heart by following the guidelines that have been elicited above. Thank you very much for the patient hearing.
Thank you, sir. Such a detailed discussion about cardiovascular management during this COVID situation. And many of you will be having some practical doubts in managing these patients. The questions we will take later together as a panel discussion. Now I request Dr. Satish Babu, is a consultant endocrinologist at First Hospital Yeshwanthpur, to talk on management of diabetes mellitus and other endocrinological diseases during this COVID pandemic.
Good afternoon. Thank you to Rajiv Gandhi University, Honorable Vice Chancellor, for giving this opportunity to share knowledge and whatever the current practice in treating COVID-19 infection with endocrine disorders. I also thank Dr. Nagaraj, who is my senior as a, when we did post graduation in medicine. So moving on to the topic, we will understand why diabetes and endocrine problems are very important in COVID infection as I enumerate or as I go through the slides. The world is being swept by COVID infection. We all know the news in the news and multiple medical webinar presentations, how it is affecting each and every individual in the world. Probably even the animals, for the good reason, nature is healing itself. So from taking that as a positive note, but unexpectedly, this infection in last 3 months has affected impacted the life and livelihood of human race in an unprecedented way across globe, and including India. We are overwhelmed with the cases just because of our demography, increased population, infrastructure, health infrastructure issues, health personnel, trained personnel. All this is having a bearing on how we manage COVID infection, more so with comorbid conditions. You all know that diabetes is very common in India. It's called as India is called as a diabetes capital of world. Almost 20% of Indian population have either diabetes or pre-diabetes. That means to say hyperglycemia. And shockingly, urban poor have increased prevalence of diabetes, whereas rural rich have increased prevalence of diabetes. And unknowingly, there are around 10% of the population not knowing that they have hyperglycemia. So all this puts our country and diabetes at the forefront in the fight against COVID infection. And what we know from whatever the accumulated global experience in last 3 months is diabetes, as the previous speaker, cardiologist Dr. Ramesh, has already mentioned, cardiac issues, diabetes, and elderly people are more prone or are at higher risk. So these studies, diabetes was comorbidity in this small study, and most of them, 50% of them, in fact, died among the 52. So the diabetes has a comorbidity was 22%, but 50% of them died in that small study requiring, that is 52 intensive care patients. In another study, the reported in prevalence was 16.2%. But what is consistent among all the studies or across the globe is twofold increase in intensive care admissions in patients with diabetes and COVID infection. Mortality is threefold higher when you compare diabetes and non-diabetic individual with comorbid condition. And this is from China. As early as February, this report came out. So with diabetes being one of the most important comorbid condition in all the forms of coronavirus infection, that is SARS, MERS, and COVID-19, And across the geography, 20 to 50% of the new COVID infection, 2019 COVID virus infection, having 20 to 50% being diabetic individuals with not uniform or accumulated experience to treat this condition, because being a novel virus infecting the continent, there was always a need for expert panel to come out with some guidance, some practical recommendations. And this international panel, containing 20 different countries who have treated for last 3 months many patients with COVID infection, of course most of them having diabetes, I've come up with some pragmatic suggestions and guidance. Let's look in my my presentation mostly is based on this paper. You can the link to the Lancet article I've quoted, you can go through. The institutes are from east to west, Hong Kong, Singapore, many institutes, many hospitals in Italy, Europe, and America. They have participated in this formulating the guidelines. So why diabetes is high risk in COVID infection? As I already mentioned, and as this previous recommendation states, that 20 to 50% of COVID infected individuals had diabetes, depending upon the geography. All forms of diabetes, be it type 1, type 2, or pancreatic diabetes, or steroid-induced diabetes, risk of infection, as you all know, is more because of inherent immune dysregulation, mainly macrophage function, T cell decreased T cell activity, and increased cytokine response. The although this is traditional known fact of diabetes and a dysregulated immune response. Recently, what coronavirus has brought forth is newer pathophysiological mechanisms specific to coronavirus. One of them has already been mentioned by cardiologists, ACE inhibitor mediated increased coronary virus replication. We will go into that, although it's not completely understood, but at least some light has been thrown by this expert panel by going into very specifically both the issue, pathophysiology, and the treatment modalities which are used for diabetes. So other reasons, you all know, high frequency of diabetes in older patients. Older patients per se are more prone for COVID disease. On top of it, somebody with elderly person with type 2 diabetes, the frequency is more likely. And all these elderly diabetic individuals mostly have comorbid conditions. In India, 80% of diabetic individuals have hypertension, what we call as twin issue, twin pathogenesis or twin pathology. Of course, Asians, especially South Asians, are at increased risk for coronary artery disease, more so in diabetes. So all this put diabetic individuals, especially elderly with comorbid conditions, more likely to have COVID infection fatalities. This is uniform across all the centers being treated with COVID infections. Two new potential hypotheses from what we understood from SARS and MERS infection and recent COVID is angiotensin converting enzyme 2 mediated virus particle entering the cell, wherever, let it be lungs, let it be beta cell, let it be kidneys, and targeting inflammatory cascade or inducing an inflammatory cascade reaction. And what is new from MERS infection also is we all use dipeptidyl inhibitors, that is DPP-4 inhibitors for diabetes, that is incretin GLP levels to go up. These are part of treatment for last 15 to 20 years. And there is a link to this receptor, this enzyme as well with COVID infection. We'll look into this. So first, to understand what happens with renin angiotensin system as a metabolic effect leading to diabetes. Multiple studies and this understanding also has led to treatment modalities, be it ACE inhibitors, be it angiotensin 2 blockers, and we all know, starting from OPE study to as recent as Steno 2, Steno 1, that
these renin angiotensin 2 blockers are low grade anti-inflammatory medications as well. In fact, there is a diabetes prevention aspect also in these studies when they looked into as a sub study secondary effects of not the primary objective. I'm talking about secondary objectives of benefits in from this medication. So whenever there is a renin angiotensin system activation, hyperactivation, there is a oxidative stress at almost all the all the important metabolic organs. You can see at liver level there is decreased insulin sensitivity, increased fibrosis, so you have fatty liver and cirrhosis being implicated to renin angiotensin activation. Whereas opposite, when you block, there is suppression of hepatic glucose output, prevent hepatic triglyceride accumulation, in turn leading to less of lipotoxicity and, of course, reduction of fibrosis and oxidative stress. When you talk about adipose tissue, again, there is a decreased insulin sensitivity, decreased glucose uptake. When you talk about pancreas as a specific organ, renin angiotensin 2 system decreases insulin activation, renin angiotensin activation decreases insulin secretion, increases beta cell oxidative stress. So they are detrimental to beta cell protection or beta cell proliferation probably, and decrease blood perfusion, causes less of probably ischemic effect as well at microvasculature. Whereas when you block renin angiotensin system, opposite is seen, insulin release is gone up, insulin islet cell perfusion is increased, decreased oxidative stress is seen. So in summary, you can call as ACE2 signal cascade activation decreases insulin release and sensitivity, whereas renin angiotensin system blockade improves beta cell function and end organ insulin sensitivity, which is the key to understand the next part of pathogenesis. So why you have seen some of the virus particle image is not coming. You have seen the coronavirus the images. There are spikes on it. This virus spike protein, what is called as glycoprotein, sits on ACE receptor, ACE2 receptor, and hijacks the endocrine pathway of angiotensin converting enzyme pathway to enter the cells, be it wherever the site of viral receptor contact be. So ACE2 mediated insult. So let's take about non-pulmonary effects, mainly from endocrine point of view. If you take ACE2 mediated virus insult in beta cell, of course there is a damage of beta cell leading to impair in insulin secretion and new onset of diabetes. Of course, pre-existing diabetes, there is increased hyperglycemia with in vitro insulin secretion decreasing. So potential beta cell damage by virus lead to insulin deficiency, causing severe diabetic ketoacidosis at the time of new hospital admission with coronavirus infection, COVID infection. This is supported by multiple observations from Italy group, and there were new diabetic older patients or adult patients presenting as in diabetic ketoacidosis, putting them into a surprise, not known to have diabetes. So this was when they analyzed, this is the best hypothesis or this is the best explanation people are giving or expert panel is giving, that is acute insult of beta cells from ACE2 mediated viral coronavirus dysfunction of islet cells. So another clinical observation to corroborate this DKA-like picture is tremendous insulin dose requirement during the course of acute COVID infection, again from groups of European groups who have treated multiple acute COVID infection, which was this insulin dose requirement was disproportionate to the severity of COVID acute illness. And if you see the other inflammatory markers to other septic conditions like bacterial sepsis or whatever the other sepsis, the insulin requirement was quite disproportionate. So putting across again this ACE or ACE-mediated beta cell dysfunction as one of the main proponents of this clinical situation. So the key point now is ACE inhibitors and angiotensin II blockers safe or not? Until now, people using ACE inhibitors and angiotensin II blockers, there is no increased infection rate, nor the worsening of the condition. So the expert panel says that beta angiotensin II blockers and ACE inhibitors, probably because of inhibition of ACE-mediated COVID infection, have a beneficial effect and quite safe to use. So as the previous cardiologist has already mentioned, there is no, as of now, indication to stop or switch over ACE inhibitors and angiotensin II blockers. Probably they have a beneficial effect by directly viral load and low grade and inhibiting the low grade oxidative stress mediated inflammatory changes happening in the body. So coming to this new MERS virus, MERS COVID infection related understanding of DPP4 enzyme. So the virus was using this enzyme as a mediator to infect the primary cells as coronavirus as other coronavirus mediating through ACE2 inhibitor. What is observed is antibodies directed against DPP4 inhibition led to a less inhibition of primary cells with this MERS coronavirus. So DPP4 receptors are, you all know, there are, it's scattered all over the body, mainly in intestine, heart, and DPP4 inhibition is the mainstay in the treatment of modern diabetic drugs. All the gliptins, vildagliptin, sitagliptin you use for diabetes treatment, and for last 20 years they have been established to be not only having glycemic edge, also cardiovascular benefits, except for saxagliptin, which is linked to heart failure. Rest all are cardiac safe, and probably if you are renal safe as well. So influence of what is not understood or what is not still known is COVID-19, that is 2019 coronavirus and DPP4 enzyme link. We know that MERS coronavirus as a link, but COVID-19 and diabetes treatment or DPP4 enzyme link is not being established until now. But being a sister virus, is there a mechanism, is what we are all interested in, especially because of the DPP4 inhibition being a mainstay in the treatment of diabetes. So what the panel concludes is mechanism of action, if translates to COVID-19 infection as well, similar to MERS infection, the use of DPP4 inhibitors to reduce DPP4 concentration could provide therapeutic opportunities as a treatment for COVID-19. So it becomes a beneficial, it becomes a one of the probably adjacent treatment agent is what they recommend or what they conclude as of today. So this is the understanding what is being new to this infection and pathogenesis and that linking to diabetes or hyperglycemia. So when it comes to mainstay treatment management of COVID-19 in diabetes, again, being one of the main comorbid condition causing serious illness with fatalities, prevention is the best way, especially when the vaccine and specific definitive treatment is not still being recommended. So prevention of COVID infection, especially in elderly and diabetic individuals, by following whatever the general recommendations of social distancing and wash, quarantine, all these measures have a big role in people with diabetes. When it comes to specific diabetes specific recommendations or instructions, a person with diabetes should still continue to, more so now, continue to be on a strict diet, regular exercise in spite of this lockdown. Whatever the simple household exercises, you should continue. With diet, you might not get, there might be restrictions and there might be limitation in the nutritious, low calorie, low carbohydrate diet availability. So you have to be extra vigilant in choosing those foodstuff. Regular monitoring makes a big difference, and being regular on medications, whatever the current medications you are on after reviewing with your doctor, and avoid visit to hospital, reviews with the doctor, let it be as a teleconsultation or over the mobile. Self-management using educational tools like leaflets, IT, mobile apps, have a big role. Cochrane data review says that self-management for diabetes with these tools have beneficial effects in short run, that is 6 months to 1 year. So that can be of a big help until we come out or until we overcome this pandemic. Diabetes with comorbidities is the key. Taking care of these individuals is the key. It should be multidisciplinary team. So combined specialties, let it be kidney, renal problem, so renal physician, cardiac problem with diabetes, so cardiologist and endocrinologist or diabetologist. So these close monitoring with combined specialties, mostly with teleconsultation or distant consultation, is what is recommended by international bodies, professional bodies. So when it comes to India and the complications, India and diabetes, age and complication is a big issue. You can see, let it be nephropathy, peripheral vascular disease or coronary vascular disease, it goes exponentially as the age worsens. And this is with diabetes, with these comorbidities. So on top of age as a primary risk factor for COVID infection, these comorbidities with diabetes puts us as a country in a different league or different mode. So we have to be more vigilant take care of these individuals by preventing COVID infection. If infected, as I already mentioned, it should be multidisciplinary specialties looking after these individuals. The spike on the virus is what the glycoprotein, which sits on ACE receptor and enters the cell, you can see. So this expert panel has come out with a consensus in management and steps of management. As an outpatient, you still continue to follow what is general rule, sanitization or sensitization and of the patients with diabetes for important key of having a good glycemic control, being regular on current therapy, appropriate therapy, and utilization of telemedicine and connected to health modalities without visiting clinics or hospital. As soon as somebody gets COVID infection, monitor or check the glucose levels to see if the new onset diabetes has set in. plasma glucose monitoring, electrolytes, pH, blood ketones, or beta ketone bodies, plasma ketone bodies has to be measured to know whether they are in decay. Liberal and early intravenous insulin therapy is what is recommended, be it a new diabetic patient with COVID infection or somebody who has pre-existing diabetes with COVID infection. IV insulin infusion would be better for titration and keeping the range for a prolonged time rather than having hypo or hypoglycemic surges. Of course, subcutaneous resorption is very erratic, more so with the septic shock-like situation in these individuals. So range, the expert committee says 72 to 144. This can be a bit more relaxed, especially on the lower end, because you will push a lot of hypoglycemia if you aim for this. Probably at around 90 to 140, 150 would be better, be it for outpatient or for inpatient management. So what we know as anti-drug, anti-diabetic drugs and concerns in COVID-19. This is another paper written by Indian, published by Indian authors from PGI Chandigarh. So they have looked into each modality of treatment of diabetes in COVID with the pretext of COVID. So insulin, there are no absolute, no human data to support poor outcomes. So it's very safe. One of the mainstay of treatment. Metformin, again, no concerns as such, but you have lactic acidosis and septic shock, renal involvement, all those issues. Of course, once patient is in ICU, metformin probably has to be discontinued. Sulfonylureas, again, in outpatient setting, absolutely no concerns. It's quite safe. Pioglitazone, it has its own issues, so not recommended. And it has a bit of upregulation of ACE in insulin-sensitive tissues of rats, so better to avoid. Glucagon-like peptide analogs, liraglutide, and the multiple other injectable forms, again, theoretically not good to use in this situation. SGLT inhibitors, although they look very promising, but because of their volume depletion, genitourinary issues, probably avoiding would be better, especially in these individuals. Fluid balance, fluid hydration becomes key when coronavirus infection goes into moderate or severity of illness. DPP-4 inhibitors, probably only agent which is favorable. So theoretically, DPP-4 modulation might help offset the cytokine-mediated acute respiratory complications of COVID. So probably it has a beneficial effect. So using DPP-4 or continuing the vildagliptin, sitagliptin, saxagliptin would be preferred. Of course, saxagliptin, you should be careful in heart failure individuals. Hydrochloroquine also has been used as an anti-diabetic agent, as a third, fourth agent. So we know from a small study from France that it reduces viral load. Can it be considered? Yes, it can be considered. But as late as yesterday, this report from NEJM, an observational study, says that hydrochloroquine administration was not associated with either a greatly lowered or increased risk of composite endpoint of intubation or death. So this these authors are proposing that it might not be beneficial, and having known that it has cardiac issues, it should be very judiciously used. So to summarize the metabolic interface effects of anti-diabetic drugs in COVID-19, metformin, as I mentioned, dehydration, lactic acidosis, especially in seriously COVID-infected ICU setting is a issue. So discontinue and monitoring renal function whenever you're using it in early stages or in OPD setting is recommended. SGLT inhibitors, again, they have their own issues. Canagliflozin, dapagliflozin, EMFA are good anti-diabetic agents, but in this situation may not be ideal. Glucagon-like peptide receptor agonists, liraglutide, exenatide extended release preparations. Again, they have dehydration-like illness. They can cause nausea, vomiting, especially in early stages. So avoiding will be better. So next agents, that is DPP-4 inhibitors. All gliptins are quite well tolerated and safe, and in fact might be beneficial is what the recommendation is. Insulin therapy is the mainstay of treatment, be it at outpatient or in inpatient diabetes management in COVID infection situation. But only issue is close monitoring and titration is the key. So this is the summary to know about in general diabetes and COVID. When you specifically ask COVID and type 1 diabetes, so type 1 diabetic in the COVID lockdown situation, you have to just review the insulin dose and the frequency of glycemic control without hypoglycemia. Doctors should probably very regularly review this situation. And they have to monitor ketone bodies as well, along with blood glucose, making sure that they are not in the tendency to go into DKA. So one aspect with SGLT inhibitors is euglycemic ketoacidosis, which I forgot to mention. So that's a very risky proposition in moderate to severely affected COVID affected patients. So that's another reason not to use SGLT inhibitors. So you have euglycemic, normal glycemic ketoacidosis as a side effect. So coming back to type 1 diabetes, regular monitoring of ketone bodies is key. Maintain hydration, diet, capillary glucose log, a logbook, and be in touch with the treating physician more so in distant methods, not visiting hospital for dose titration. Once type 1 diabetic develops COVID infection, he should be treated as with IV insulin in infusion from beginning itself to keep somewhere around 90 to 150 blood glucose, and closely monitoring electrolytes and fluid balance. Preventing ketosis in this situation is the key to the reducing the critical outcome. Diabetes and pregnancy, diabetes in pregnancy. So somebody having pre-existing diabetes becoming pregnant, like type 1 diabetic or type 2 diabetic individuals becoming pregnant, again, the same principles holds good. It should be multidisciplinary, both obstetrician and endocrinologist closely monitoring. So management protocol, with a set management protocol being discussed with the individual quite early in pregnancy. So low carbohydrate diet, specific exercises, monitoring, and the insulin is the treatment of choice in this situation. You have to stop OHS and manage only with insulin. Regular obstetric and fetal scanning as routinely as guidelines state, national guidelines state. Gestational diabetes, that is pregnant diabetes, new onset of diabetes during pregnancy, screening and management doesn't change, it's same. This is from RCOG guidelines. So coming to other endocrine disorders in COVID, main endocrine issue would be steroid requiring conditions, especially endocrine conditions, Addison's disease, hypopituitarism, and of course steroid as a medical treatment. Endocrine conditions where steroid is used as a replacement is different. Medical conditions where steroids are used as a treatment in supraphysiological doses, most of the times is different. So these two issues, again, the principals would be monitoring closely and regularly for hyperglycemia or new onset diabetes. Electrolyte, sodium and potassium issues can be both from pre-existing condition and as a steroid hyper or hyper replacement. Fluid balance will be a key issue. Strict preventive precautions followed for COVID is mandatory, more so because these individuals are immunosuppressed. You have to follow sick day rule as soon as they become unwell. So you have to escalate the dose of steroids if they can take orally. As soon as they become acutely unwell, you have to switch over to IV steroid, IV hydrocortisone as a steroid replacement, probably given at fourth hourly, 50 to 100 milligrams would suffice. Other endocrine issues, mainly obesity and overweight. This situation has dysmetabolism with insulin resistance, lipid issues, fatty liver, they have hypertension, ischemic heart disease. All these metabolic parameters make COVID infection more fatal whenever an obese individual develops infection. More than that, ventilation perfusion issues, obstructive sleep apnea as an issue, all this this adds to whatever the metabolic issues are on top of detrimental to the fatality of the individual. So coming to thyroid disease, it's very common thyroid in common prevalence next to diabetes. So I thought it should be mentioned, but not much of a change in management. You have to both treat hypo and hyper to keep it as close to euthyroidism as possible, as quickly as possible, which is the only way to manage COVID-19 and thyroid disease, if at all, if it coexists. So with this, I thank once again for your patient listening, and thank Rajiv Gandhi University for this opportunity. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Sutil Prabhu, giving a very practical guidelines for management of diabetes during this COVID situation. Now I request Dr. Shashi Bhushan, Professor of Pulmonology, BMCRI, to give a talk on management of chronic respiratory disease.
Thank you, sir. At the outset, I would like to thank Honorable Vice Chancellor Dr. Sachidananda and Dr. Nagaraj, Professor Medicine Department of Medicine, Victoria Hospital, Waring Hospital, to giving an opportunity to talk on management of chronic respiratory disease during pandemic of COVID-19. As all of you know that a lot of been talk about COVID-19. I'm just briefing, and you can pose questions so that will be a better option. I'll brief about what is happening in chronic respiratory conditions. You all know that whenever a patient with severe acute respiratory syndrome, that is ARDS or pneumonia, these are the patients who are vulnerable for severe diseases. So as per the NHS recommendation, what is told is to reduce the human contact, that we have been telling since long time, physical distancing, so that by doing this, the contracting of the virus itself is avoided. So to basically, once a patient gets in with severe comorbidities, the burden to the health system is increased. To prolong his stay in the ICU, all these are reduced. So which are the chronic conditions in respiratory? As all of you know that it is COPD, asthma, bronchiectasis, it could be cystic fibrosis, ILD, or pulmonary hypertension. In the recent publications in the New York Times, COPD has been listed as the 8th probable cause for the co-infection with COVID-19. So COPD is one which associated can lead to increased mortality. It can be probably due to age, smoking, and frailty. As per the European Respiratory Journal, the analysis done that comorbid conditions in 1,590 patients in China, it found out that COPD is again the predominant predisposed cause for adverse infection in COVID-19. So what are the general precautions we need to take? Like we've been telling since long again, over and again, that like any individual with any chronic respiratory condition, the best approach would be always they should stay at home as much as possible, avoid getting into the crowds or large gathering, and continue to use the regular medicine and ensure adequate medications are taken regularly, and practice a regular hand hygiene. So by washing the hands with warm water or sanitizer, if they're washing the hands for minimum 20 seconds to wash continuously. So, and do not touch their mouth, nose or eyes with unwashed hands. Keep away from others who are sick, both when inside and outside, and ask anyone who has symptoms, whoever has been symptoms, to avoid not to go to them or visit them. So surgical masks on a regular basis should be worn by especially elderly with chronic comorbidities. So if they're going outside also, it is suggested that they wear the mask regularly. A routine surgical mask, a triple layer mask would be more ideal. So coming to COPD, what you need to know about COPD. What happens in COPD? Routinely when a patient is infected, COVID-19, what happens is there is an alteration in the local or systemic inflammatory response, which leads to impaired host immunity, and there is an imbalance which leads to persistent mucus production, and there could be a structural damage as these patients are using inhaled corticosteroid, which has been hypothesized, and so that tendency for getting community acquired pneumonia is more likely. And with respect to COVID-19, the levels of angiotensin converting enzymes, the reported receptors, these receptors are vulnerable, the virus is vulnerable for the receptor, causing their affinity for the virus is more in COPD patients. In a concise meta-analysis demonstration done, which shows that there is a five-fold increase of severe COVID infection in COPD patients. So patients with a coexisting COPD should encourage to adopt more restrictive measures for minimizing potential exposure to SARS. Basically, they should avoid getting going outside, staying indoors. That would be a more ideal way of dealing things. So clinicians should also be careful to monitor all COPD patients with suspected infections. What are the potential benefit or harms of an inhaled patient? You see, most of the COPD patients are inhaled steroid. So what is the benefit or what is the harm in using an inhaled steroid is still unclear, because this disease is just 4 months old. So we need to collect a lot of data associated comorbidities or a patient who has been infected once they come back on a follow-up. So we can only definitely have a say on whether how benefit or how harmful of these therapy along with associated infection is. As per the GOLD guidelines, as all of you know that GOLD has also come out with the guidance as what has to be done. So it says that people with COPD are amongst the worst affected by COVID-19. So it's working with WHO to try to minimize the impact of infection, but how we need to wait and watch. It strongly encourages people with COPD to follow the advice of public health teams in their own countries and try to minimize the chance of being infected. Seek help if they show symptoms of any infection, and if there is any scientific evidence to support the inhaled corticosteroid, we still don't know how it is, what is the scientific evidence. So whether it should be avoided or not, we still know. But still, as of the routine practices, they need to continue their regular medications. If there are an oxygen, oxygen therapy should be provided following the standard recommendation. Coming to asthma, the World Asthma Day was celebrated 4 days back, 3 days back, that is on May 5th. So the theme for this year is enough asthma deaths. That's the theme for this year. this year. So what happens with asthma and COVID-19? Again, the GINA has come out with a statement, like the summary of the statement, what it says is people with asthma should continue to use all their inhaled medication, including inhaled corticosteroid as prescribed by the doctor. There is no change in medications. So you should not suggest or advise your patient that they need to continue what the medications they're taking as earlier. So there is no stoppage of any inhaled steroids or inhaled corticosteroids. So in case of acute asthma, how to manage? So along with the inhaled steroid, if you require a short course of oral corticosteroid, can be instructed. So to prevent any further serious consequences. In a rare cases, patient with severe asthma who require long-term treatment or with oral corticosteroids on top of their inhaled medication, the treatment should be continued in the lowest possible dose in these patients as risk of exacerbation or more. So other medications, like if they're on omalizumab, mepolizumab, like biologics, what you know about, these has to be continued in order to limit the oral corticosteroid as much as possible. When it comes to nebulization, ideally speaking, as per the guidelines, to be avoided. So due to increased risk of generating aerosols, that is droplet nuclei and dissemination of the COVID-19, it is advised not to use a nebulizer. So ideally, what is suggested is a MDI, pressurized metered dose with a spacer, is preferred during the treatment, whether in the ICU or at home, for any type of such patients with COVID. So this is one important thing we should know about. If for a severe attack, the maintenance inhaled asthma treatment should also be continued at home and in the hospital also, same thing. So if the patient is also having allergic rhinitis, they can use the nasal corticosteroid as prescribed as earlier. Routinely, as of now, the present situation, spirometry is to be suspended because again, it can reduce the risk of viral transmission, and absolutely necessary, it is suggested. Otherwise, spirometry is not a must. Coming to bronchiectasis. So what are the things you should know? Because why I'm talking about all these things, we have had real experience situation with asthma, with COPD, with bronchiectasis, with tuberculosis, with obstructive sleep, all patients we have seen with COVID. So coming to bronchiectasis, so in case of bronchiectasis, there is likely increased risk of respiratory infections, and which leads to a poor outcome. So even a patient with mild bronchiectasis has a high risk of complications. So who are the patients whom need to be taken precautions in case of bronchiectasis? So those receiving prophylactic antibiotics such as inhaled antibiotics or macrolides, those with chronic Pseudomonas aeruginosa infection, those experiencing 3 or more exacerbation per year, those associated with airflow obstruction or significant breathlessness, those with chronic pulmonary aspergillosis, those receiving non-tubercular mycobacterium pulmonary, NTMs. So these are the patients who are at risk. So these can, with bronchiectasis, can land up in severe COVID infections. Coming to interstitial lung disease. The ILD and COVID-19, they can go hand in hand with existence. The lung injury and repair caused by COVID-19 is similar like that of any ILD. So the onset of disease and progression to ILD, still we exactly do not know the pathogenesis, but once the patient comes for follow-up, definitely we'll have a real picture of the ILD, what type of ILD is happening in COVID-19. So it is difficult to distinguish as of now. So as clinicians, we need to comprehensively analyze the epidemic history, the disease onset characteristics, clinical manifestations, image characteristics, serologic and pathogenic mechanism tests, which can result and confirm the diagnosis. Can COVID cause ILD? That's what I was trying to tell you, that most of the patients develop into acute respiratory distress, and which results in respiratory failure and need for mechanical ventilation. So in an attempt, or if they come out of all these severe acute respiratory distress syndrome, there is a the healing process happens, which leads to fibrosis. So this fibrosis, again, it's a form of ILD. So this can compound the injury which already exists in a patient with ILD and can be a life-threatening illness. So what does the ILD in British Thoracic Society document say? So there is definitely a fast evolving situation in this document as per the BTS guidelines. So it says that so even if the patient is on antifibrotic drugs, that is like pirfenidone or nintedanib, these patients may be at risk due to their age. It can be due to an underlying chest disease with or without comorbidities. And there is, if already on these drugs, there is no need to alter these drugs due to the outbreak. The drugs will continue to same even in case of COVID-19. So once diagnosed COVID-19 or admitted, it is not considered harmful to stop these medications. It is not considered harmful to pause the drugs for a short period of time, around 4 to 8 weeks. ILD patients already established on immunosuppressions is to keep taking them unless they are experiencing symptoms of infection, and if found positive, we need to stop immunosuppression medication during infection, and usually it may last for 2 weeks after recovery. So I'll just give you one case scenario. A patient with systemic sclerosis and a COVID. Here, it's a 57-year-old woman with systemic sclerosis who developed COVID-19. This patient was already on an anti-interleukin-6 receptor, that is tocilizumab, with a 8 mg per kg body weight every week for 4 weeks intravenously. 4 weeks after the last tocilizumab infusion, patient comes with mild symptoms of COVID and her test for COVID turns out to be positive. She is managed symptomatically and declared cured after RT-PCR test, which turned out to be negative at 10 days. So this single case report, well, the authors say that what it says is that IL-6 blocking treatment given for for chronic autoimmune disease such as rheumatoid arthritis or connective tissue disease may prevent the development severe COVID-19, because she was already on tocilizumab, so this can prevent a cytokine storm. So that's how she never went into severe. She was managed with in a mild COVID situation. Coming to tuberculosis, so what? Because we are seeing a lot of our country. We are seeing plenty of patients with tuberculosis. What do you need to know when a patient with if there is a coexistence of COVID-19 with tuberculosis? So with our experience is limited, but we have seen in our institute a patient with tuberculosis, also we have treated a patient. So it is anticipated that people ill with both TB and COVID may have a poor outcome, but our experience is totally different what we have seen in our institute. So let me finish this and I'll try to tell you about what we have seen in different scenarios. We are talking about how BCG helps or how it protects COVID-19. But as of now, there is no evidence that BCG protects people against infection with COVID-19 virus. The two clinical trials which addressed these questions which are underway, even the WHO has been evaluating whether it is helpful. But there is experimental evidence from both animal and human studies that BCG has non-specific effect on immune system. These effects have not been well characterized and the clinical relevance is unknown. On 11th April 2020, WHO updated its ongoing epidemic review of the major scientific database and clinical trial repositories using English, French, Chinese, and these terms with BCG. The work is still going on. Three preprint manuscripts have been in which authors have been compared that incidence of COVID-19 in countries where the BCG vaccine is used, where it is not used, and there was a differentiation in countries where used and where BCG was not used, and observed that the countries that routinely use the vaccine in neonates has less reported case of COVID-19 to date. But still, such ecological studies, we are still have limited significant, and it can be biased also. We don't know about these things. Mm-hmm. Coming to the what strategies as per the National Elimination Tuberculosis Control Program, certain, this is very new, which has come down yesterday only. So these are the strategies for TB cases finding in Karnataka in the wake of COVID-19 lockdown. What has happened is there is a significant drop in case notification rates to 71% in the month of April and dropped to 60% of case current cases when compared to the same indicators in the previous year, last year. So the probably they found out that following reasons could be quoted in the fall in TB notification. That is, it could be a reduced patient accessibility to health facilities due to lockdown, decreased OPD functionality at healthcare facilities, decreased active TB finding activities in the field, apprehension of the TB lab technician on performing sputum smear examination, conversion of the facilities with TB diagnostic facility into designated COVID hospitals. So that is what has happened in our hospital also. So the what the study, they, the state as for, the National Strategic Plan has formed four approaches. That is, what has to be done is all presumptive TB patients to be identified by house-to-house visit by ASHA workers and enrolled in presumptive TB register. These patients to be further screened on chest X-ray and CBNet. All COVID-negative patients, details to be collected from RT-PCR labs, and these patients traced back and tested for TB by offering upfront CBNet. So this is very important. So we have to start practicing these things. And all persons who have contacted the Aptamitra care line in Karnataka to be contacted, traced back, and specimen collected and tested for TB by offering, again, upfront CBNet. All ILI SARI patients admitted in various hospitals of the state must be tested for TB by, again, offering them upfront CBNet. So in a situation with TB and MDR, so what are we supposed to do with a, when a patient with MDR patient is there or TB patient is there? So we ask them to stay at home and shift to virtual care. So the suggestion is the patient can receive multiple months of medicine so that he does not come out of the his house. And his monitoring, regular careful monitoring has to be done. Any adverse reaction, he has to inform the doctor over the phone and shift all injection free to oral medications in case of MDR regimen. The family member will be made as a treatment supporter, and virtual treatment support and digital adherence through either telemedicine. This is what everywhere we are planning to start, avoiding asking them to go to hospital, avoid them to going to hospitals, especially because if there is a comorbid issue, this again will cause more problems, and follow the national TB elimination guidelines as per the government of India. In case of obstructive sleep apnea, what you are supposed to do? As per the guidance regarding OSA with COVID, for people who routinely use CPAP, what is being suggested is routine, basically we try to avoid them coming to the hospital. They can continue the usage of CPAP, remote monitoring with telephone consultation if there is an option for them. Even the delivery of the mask and equipment from sleep center should be encouraged without patient attending or coming to the hospital. What is the advice? So people with OSA should continue CPAP at home as normal, and there is no evidence to say that using CPAP makes you more likely to catch COVID-19, and nothing to suggest that CPAP will make you more unwell if you don't catch it. Any respiratory infection, particularly with a blocked nose, can make the CPAP too difficult to use. But if wearing CPAP makes you feel worse either by coughing or disturbing, then stop using it until your respiratory symptoms improve. You may wish to distance. That's what we try to tell the patient. Distance from vulnerable household members by changing bedrooms or stopping CPAP for a short time. And they should be isolated in case if they're at high risk, isolated in a separate room. So sleeping upright and avoiding alcohol and using mandibular advancement split if you have anyone or may have an alternative to CPAP. This is, but again, stopping for some time would be more ideal because they cannot have a replacement for that. So these are all not possible. So if it worsen, but can restart after some time. So basically, again, here again, we need to suggest routine hygiene. Infection control is suggested. Ask them to change machine filters routinely, cleaning surfaces, cleaning the mask and tubing with hand hot soap water, and washing hands regularly. Mask and machine should not be shared, so as the infection can spread. So for advice for a person with OSA who routinely uses CPAP, who's unwell or admitted due to suspected or confirmed, so they have to bring the CPAP. Even if they don't bring also, there are ways to manage. We have managed in our setup. So do not use CPAP unless instructed by the staff. You may ask not to use CPAP for OSA in an open ward because it can produce aerosol. So this can again lead to an infection. So basically avoiding would be a better thing. If it is associated with obesity hypoventilation, requiring CPAP to maintain ventilation, this should be continued, but we'll need an isolation. So that is what suggestion, what we are suggesting. And requirement of a negative pressure ward would be a more ideal. So to reduce the risk of infection from CPAP while you are in the hospital, what you are supposed to do? Usually, which has a vent to allow you to breathe, these things you can be, there could be a temporary mask usage which will not have this vent, but a bacterial or viral filter can also be added along with the exhalation port in the tube. So advise not to use a humidifier with a CPAP, especially in a hospital setup due to droplet spread. So I've got some few case series, what we have, real situation, what we have seen in our hospital. We have seen all type of patient. So this is again a patient with tuberculosis. So I'm putting a 62-year-old. He's a age itself is in the high risk. He's having diabetes. He's having tuberculosis. This is a high risk patient. So he was referred from a private hospital with severe breathlessness. His gene export was positive. So we got a X-ray done. X-ray, you can see on the left side, a cavitated lesion in the left parahilar region. We got a CT done. In our institute, we are trying to get CTs for all the patients. This is a CT with a COVID with a tuberculosis patient. It is nothing different. So what you can see is same. There is nothing different from a routine COVID associated with a tuberculosis. So initially, he was not tolerating an anti-tuberculosis. His LFT was deranged. We stopped him on anti-tubercular medications, gave him treatment only for COVID-19. So he recovered, he has gone back home. So we had to stop his ATT for some time. So he improved a lot, following which we discharged him and advised him to take his anti-tubercular treatment after repeating of CBNAT. So this is one case with tuberculosis with COVID. So this is again a patient with OSA who was on home CPAP therapy. He was also a known hypertensive diabetes, 63-year-old male. So obstructive sleep apnea. He has multiple comorbidities, but his X-ray showed infiltration, bilateral infiltration. This is in the early phase of our admission. We could not get a CT of this patient. What we did was, again, we didn't give him CPAP therapy. We gave him high flow nasal oxygen. So high flow nasal oxygen itself acted like a CPAP. So he also recovered from his infection. He's gone home. This person is also discharged. And This again, COPD with COVID-19 positive. This COPD patient was asymptomatic. When he came to us, he was asymptomatic, diagnosed with COPD. We treated him. This person is also discharged. So coming to the, this is again 27-year-old male who's still in the hospital with us. He's a case of bronchiectasis. Known case of bronchiectasis, present to us with COVID positive, was admitted in the ward. His main complaint was breathlessness on exertion. When he, for little distance of walking, he was having breathlessness. So we got a CT done. It was shown as cylindrical bronchiectasis. So what we did was we gave him the routine protocol, what we are following in our institute, gave him bronchodilators, gave him oxygen, which helped him a lot. And now you are waiting for his COVID result to come negative for discharge. So what I would suggest, take home message is, any patient with chronic respiratory disease may be appear to be vulnerable both in infection and subsequent severe disease. Patient with chronic lung disease who may be at risk, like COPD, asthma, bronchiectasis, ILD, all such patients should follow general instruction of staying at home, practice social distancing, hand hygiene, cough etiquettes. There are a lot of meta-analysis to demonstrate that COPD is associated with significant five-fold increase of infection, especially with COVID-19. So we are seeing all those data coming up. So ideally, nebulizers should be avoided. In place of nebulizers, should use metered-dose inhaler. And there is no evidence of BCG to say that it protects against infection with COVID-19 infection. So one message more important is, what I would like to give is, we as doctors should inculcate saying that there is no fear amongst us or among the patient to say that it is a dreaded disease. There are more dreaded diseases like tuberculosis, which causing more deaths rather than COVID-19. So these are the things. So we have seen real situation, COVID-19 with tuberculosis, COVID-19 with COPD, bronchiectasis, all have been treated, OSA, all have gone home. So the one major, most important thing I would think is, you have to see for hypoxemia. A patient asymptomatic may be hypoxemic. So especially comorbid patients who are hypoxemic should be immediately taken care of, given oxygen. Oxygen is the most important thing in COVID-19, before any treatment. So I end this talk by telling these things. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Shashi Bhushan. Such a nice presentation, and also telling the practical management. Because what I want now is, we wanted to discuss more of practical aspects. Okay. First, we'll come to Dr. Ramesh. Meanwhile, we'll encourage the attendees to post their questions. Dr. Ramesh, you told about acute coronary syndromes. So ECG patients, ECG is taken, and we don't want their cardiac biomarkers are not encouraged. Okay. In such a situation, how to pick up coronary syndromes? Many a times ECG is normal, you don't want biomarkers. Then practically, how to approach such patients?
And that's a very good and important question, and a lot of practical aspect also. So biomarkers are always raised in a coronary infection, whether the underlying cardiac is involved or not. The only way to know whether the patient has got acute coronary syndrome like ST elevation is to do an echocardiogram where there is a region wall motion abnormality. If at all you want to do echocardiogram and it is absolutely necessary, which is going to change your line of treatment, it should be done with the proper precautions like wearing a PPE. The echocardiogram is the only one which can differentiate whether the patient has got.
You are not relying on biomarkers for the echocardiogram.
Because that's a false claim. Yeah.
Yeah. Otherwise, it will be very much restricted. Yeah. We may miss patients. Okay. So, in other words, to conclude your talk, so what are the practical guidelines you want to tell? So, whether all the patients hypertension, you don't want to change their treatment. Everybody who are on ACE inhibitors, ARBs, they are going to continue their treatment. Whatever the medications for the cardiac failure is there, everything is, you are going to continue. Nothing you are going to change. Okay, if any new onset cardiac illness like cardiomyopathy is there or arrhythmias is there, they need to be recognized. I think that will be the summary. Okay. Or anything you want to add practical? No. I want some crisp practical points.
All cardiac drugs which are being used during the pre-COVID pandemic stage should be continued as per the recommendations and guidelines given by the respective authorities.
Yes.
The only thing is we need to keep a watch over the cardiac toxicity of the drug that is being used. This can get amplified when you are using antiviral drugs. So the combination, for example, antibiotic azithromycin with the hydrochloroxine, that could cause conduction disturbances and cardiomyopathy. So one should keep a watch over the side effects. Except for that, I don't think the treatment strategy should change.
So everything continues?
Continues.
Well, coming to you, Dr. Satish Babu, practically, so managing these patients, mild patients, you don't want their medications need to be changed. If they have got a mild symptoms, even though they are COVID positive, they have got a mild symptoms. So there is no need to change. But only thing what you are telling was about pioglitazone. Whether you want them, somebody is on pioglitazone, you want them to be stopping pioglitazone?
I would say stop it because of multiple reasons. One, pioglitazone receptors, again, they are like something like angiotensin II receptors, which we don't know what the interaction is. And two, for pre-COVID pioglitazone rough weather, both as fluid retention, cardiac issues, bladder CA, all these issues are there. Why? And there are multiple other OHAs which are good. And most probably, pioglitazone, even if it is used, it's used in a small group. If you ask me what is the clear one indication for pioglitazone in my clinical practice, lipodystrophic. If there is a person with lipodystrophic phenotype, you can easily pick up most of the times in females. They will have muscular absolute lack of subcutaneous tissue, not what you see in usual females. So in males it can be a bit difficult. So the indications itself are narrow, and with coronavirus infection,
better to stop. So in all critically individual.
And one extra point for mild, whatever the glycemic, whatever the oral agents or whatever the specific treatment they're on, keeping glycemic control in a good level has shown to be beneficial. One Chinese study which I forgot to put in more, the study clearly reduced diabetes related mortality from 7.7 to 2.6 in their recruited patients for a significant number, around 700 and odd. So the good glycemic control during the illness reduced mortality from 7.7 to 2.6, which is what the Chinese group go on to say. Whatever may be the treatment options for diabetes, keep the glycemic control as strictly as good as possible.
So in critically ill patients, obviously you want to stop all oral drugs. Insulin is the best choice.
Yes.
So while giving insulin also, intravenous is the preferred one rather than subcutaneous because of aerotic absorption.
Yeah. Well, probably people at COVID coronavirus infected individual managed in inpatient non-ICU setting, you could probably go on to use subcutaneous multiple doses like basal bolus. Once they land up in ICU, once they have moderate SARS and above acute SARS-like syndrome, switching over to IV insulin is preferred.
Okay, out of curiosity, any new onset of diabetes in these COVID patients? Because viral infections are known to trigger new onset diabetes.
A lot of Italian observation studies have shown new onset of diabetic ketoacidosis, in fact, in adults. And they go on to hypothesize saying that ACE levels, ACE receptors in beta cells, through that pathway, viral particle damages the beta cell function, islet cell damage happens, so there is acute insulin deficiency. leading to new onset diabetes. And in fact, type 2 diabetic presenting as a DKA is not heard at all. Or I would put it like this, new onset adult diabetic presenting as DKA is not heard at all. This is an acute illness which is again multi-system, multi-organ involvement at the pathogenesis at the early level itself. Not ICU patient having multi-organ failure because of inflammatory cascade. I'm talking about coronavirus itself because of angiotensin 2 receptor mediated cell damage or viremia. You have multiple organs, which is in from endocrine point of view, pancreatic beta cell being implicated, being caused. And of course, the other corollary to this is huge disproportionate increased insulin requirement in ICU setting in acutely unwell patients with COVID infection. Again, that says that on top of septic shock-like related issues, there is endogenous insulin deficiency from pancreas being affected from coronavirus directly, leading to your question of new onset of diabetes.
Thank you.
The expert group has clearly said Italian group observed new onset DKA in non-existing diabetes.
Thank you. Dr. Shashi Bhushan, so what will be your summary, practical points, take-home points?
Yeah.
So yours also, especially in COPD and bronchial asthma, you want all their previous medications to continue.
Yes.
Okay, including steroids, both inhaled. Exceptionally, even oral steroids if there are.
Usually,
Exceptionally oral. So you want them to continue that.
Yeah.
Okay.
Our advice for any COPD or asthma patient. Our advice for any COPD or asthma patient is to continue the medication as earlier. Try to avoid using oral steroids. So we only ask them to continue there. Usually, oral steroid is not being given to our patients or asthma or COPD. Only during when they are admitted, probably short course will be given. So ideally speaking, they need to continue their medications whatever be their weight. Been on earlier.
So regarding nebulization, we don't want nebulization because of aerosol generation.
Yes.
Okay, MDRI, but very sick patients, I don't think they'll be able to take the MDIs with spacers. In such patients, what is the alternative?
In case of such patients, what you can do is you can, along with the nebulizer, you should go for a hood. Hood-like system.
Well, that's why I'm asking you.
So you can avoid that aerosol being spread. So these are available now. Hoods are available. So this can be prevented. So ideally speaking, what we are suggesting is even at home, the patient is on nebulization, we are asking them to shift to MDIs.
I have a question, Sushil.
Yes, sir.
What is your take on ethanol nebulization? That's a new thing that has been. Any inputs? Because alcohol, when you inhale alcohol, it kills the virus. Just like we have an
anti-hand sanitizer.
Is it advisable?
I have got no experience on that.
Okay.
One take-home message I want to re-stress again is that even a mild patient can come with hypoxemia. So what we are seeing, a lot of death in young age is probably the patient is all right, his saturation will be normal. So suddenly he collapses or something happens, uneventful activity which can cause death. Probably one is thrombosis, is one possibility, hypoxemia. So always what we are suggesting is all the patients with comorbidities should be monitored. So they should be, ideally, if their saturation is around 96 normal, I would suggest to start them on oxygen. So that would be the monitoring and giving them oxygen would be the best treatment.
I thank Dr. Ramesh, Dr. Satish Babu, Dr. Shashi Bhushan, our panelists, for their time and their sharing their experiences with us. And also I'm grateful to Professor S. Sachidananda sir, Honorable Vice Chancellor of RGHS. Sir,
Thank you, Dr. Nagaraj. I'm sure all of you sat through these 2 hours of academic feast. You understood like what is the importance of comorbidities in COVID-19 infection, and controlling these comorbidities also has a direct influence on the outcome of COVID-19 patients. So be it hypertension, be it diabetes, or any respiratory COPD for that matter, if there is a good control, the outcome of COVID-19 would definitely be much better. And three panelists have emphasized that point, saying that, you know, there should be a good control. So comorbidities and above 60 years, you know, these are the important factors. And I think female gender, they have observed much, to the dismay of all of us, that these are the factors which causes mortality more. And I'm sure most of the other doubts have been cleared. Whatever doubts you had have been clarified. And this pursuit of training doctors online in all aspects of the COVID-19 disease, which is a very, very peculiar disease all of us are facing for the first time. And the dynamics of this disease is changing day by day. And all of us need to update ourselves to tackle this disease. There are so many controversial issues. Because of no specific drugs available, there are so many things floating in the air. So I think all those doubts have been cleared by the experts here today. Thank you so much. I thank all of you for joining us and being with us on this training program. And Rajiv Gandhi University of Health Sciences is committed to pass on authentic information to all the healthcare workers, and that is what we are doing. Thank you so much. I wish you all good luck. Stay at home, stay healthy, and stay safe. Thank you so much.
Thanks.